Hi, it's Reverend Elizabeth. Are you ready for the next installment of the Rainbow Dragon? We're on installment 14 now. And if you'll remember, Delia, Jared, and Lou just crossed the desert where they and encountered the tribes at the other side. They're on their way to the Ring of Fire. Our story continues. Delia was a little nervous with the way the tribal people were looking at her, pointing at her curly hair and babbling away in their strange language. Jared didn't like the way they were looking at her either. His hand went automatically to his hip, where he typically carried the old practice sword he'd been given as a gift, but it was missing, already confiscated by the people in the mysterious blue robes. One of them said something to him, mounted his horse, and reached a hand back down, motioning to Jared to climb up behind him. Jared waited until he saw Delia safely mounted in front of another of the riders before he took the hand that was reaching out to him. The ride to the campsite took only a few minutes, and Jared was relieved to see Lou sitting in clear view. He and Delia hurried over to sit near their guide. "Hey, kids," said Lou with a smile. "You hungry? These folks are some of the best cooks you'll ever meet." "Yes, I'm starving," said Jared, "but I'm nervous too. They took my sword away, and I don't like the way they're looking at us, especially Delia." Lou placed a calming hand on Jared's arm. "Now, you've got to realize that the tribe has a different culture, a different way of getting along, but you've got nothing to worry about. Hospitality is their highest and most sacred value. They're not going to hurt you, and I think the way they're looking at Delia is meant to be a compliment. They think she's pretty." "Still, I don't like it," said Jared. "Hello," said Delia. "I'm sitting right here. I'm a little nervous too, but it's not like they're hurting us or anything. So, Jared, chill out. Lou, will you please stick close, though? We don't speak their language and we don't understand their culture. And I don't know about Jared, but that does make me uncomfortable." Lou looked pretty uncomfortable himself. "Well, that's the thing, Delia. Around here, the girls stay separate from the men and boys. In fact, unless I'm mistaken, those two women are on their way to take you to the girls' tents." Sure enough, a girl about Delia's age and an older woman approached Jared, Lou, and Delia and bowed low. They jabbered something at Lou, who replied, and then the girl took hold of Delia's hand and began to tug her away. "Lou," said Delia, starting to panic. "Don't worry, Delia, they'll take good care of you," said Lou, waving happily. Jared, meanwhile, started to follow his friend, but discovered the way blocked by one of the blue-robed tribesmen. "Lou," he said, "I'd feel better if we could stick together." "Sorry, kiddo," said Lou. "Doesn't work like that, but she'll be fine." Meanwhile, Delia found herself being led first to a warm pool. Delighted to have the chance to bathe properly, she tried to thank the girl who had guided her there. The girl just giggled and nodded her head. Delia scrubbed every inch. It felt so good to be clean again. When she'd finished, the girl offered her a clean cloth to dry herself with, and then some clean blue robes similar to the ones she herself was wearing. Once Delia was dressed, the girl got out a comb. Delia reached out her hand, but the girl shook her head and motioned instead for Delia to sit down. Then she began patiently combing the snarls out of Delia's curly hair. "I don't even know what to call you," said Delia. Then, pointing to herself, she said her own name. "Delia, Delia." The girl caught on quickly and responded, "Sana." "Sana, what a pretty name," said Delia, starting to relax. Sana not only combed Delia's hair, but she braided it in a long braid down her back. Then she gave Delia a headscarf and mimed eating. "Food?" asked Delia. "Oh, that would be lovely." Sana led her around a corner and into a tent, where a splendid feast of dates, figs, goat cheese, and green tea had already been laid out, along with several loaves of flat bread. Delia ate her fill and then decided to try to communicate a little more. "Bread," she said, pointing to the bread. "Pita," said Sana, catching on immediately. "Tea," said Delia, pointing to the liquid in her cup. "Shai," responded Sana. "Pita," said Delia, "shai," and the girl repeated, "bread, tea." They went on like this for quite a while, branching out from the names of things in the room to miming things like horseback riding and swimming. By the time night fell, Delia felt a little more at home. She still couldn't understand much of what people were saying, but she'd recognize a word here or there, and between the words she knew and sign language, she'd managed to communicate all of her needs. Meanwhile, Lou, despite his fluency in the tribe's language, had failed to locate a guide to take them into the mountains to search for the Green Dragon. I don't understand it, he said to Jared, a little frustrated. They all agree that he's up there, and most of them seem to know just where he is, but when I ask them to show us where, they just shake their heads and say, "Not me, not me." Do any of them say why not? I think, answered Lou, they're saying something about it not being their place. We could probably find Zelyonov ourselves, but we'd waste valuable time wandering around looking for him. I really think we'd be better off with a guide. Looking up at the giant rugged mountains looming against the evening sky, Jared had to agree. Well, he said to Lou, we might as well stay the night anyway and eat some food. Maybe you'll figure it out before we have to head out tomorrow morning. Maybe, said Lou. They feasted on roasted meat, root vegetables, flatbread, and more of the sweetened goat's milk. When everyone had eaten, the tribesmen took turns acting out their legends and stories. It was fascinating, but a little strange to be watching people tell dramatic tales in a language that sounded to their ears like gibberish. But Lou translated faithfully, and Jared at least got the basic gist of what was going on. Then, long after the sun had gone down, a woman stood up on the other side of the fire. Immediately the camp grew quiet. She began speaking in a dark, compelling voice. She calls herself the Dragon Singer, said Lou, and says she'll tell the story of her trial by fire. When she was a girl of 12, the great dragon Zelyonov sent her a special dream calling her to the mountain to the chamber of fire. 3 nights she dreamed, 3 days she dismissed the dreams as foolish fancies. The fourth night the dream came again, more terrible than ever before, and she knew she must obey the dragon and face her doom. So she rose early in the morning and snuck away from camp, wearing only her robes and sandals and carrying only a skin of water and her little eating knife. All day she walked, higher and higher, following the sound of Zelyonov's voice. At sunset, she arrived at the gate to his kingdom and passed through the mighty black doors. The doors slammed shut behind her, and she was in the dark. Seeing a faint glow in the distance, she began to walk toward it. She noticed heat and the smell of sulfur getting stronger and stronger. At last, she came to a passage that took her into a chamber where the lake of fire was. She called for Zelyonov. He answered her call and lay down across the fiery lake, making his body into a bridge. As she walked across his back, the heat was terrible, and it burned her hair and her eyes. On an island surrounded by the lava, she talked with Zelyana for 3 days. He taught her about the land above. He taught her about the land below. He told her the names of the stars. Then he told her she must return and teach all that she knew to her people. There would be resistance, he knew, and so he marked her eyes and her hair and gave her the great emerald as a sign of his favor. At this, the woman threw back her hood, and indeed, her eyes were bright green and her hair was curly, just like Delia's. He said one day another would come, similarly marked, and now that day has come. Lou paused, startled. Oh my goodness, that's what's going on. They believe Delia's the one the dragon told her about. The day has come, he continued, and she's directed her own daughter to take us to the cave with the fiery lake to meet Zelyonov. Her daughter will pass over the lake with us in hopes of being granted the same favor as her mother. We're to set out in the morning, finished Lou, as the woman regally returned to her seat and accepted a cup of tea. Well, that explains that then, he smiled at Jared. We'd better get some sleep. The next morning, they packed up their things and accepted food and drink gratefully. Then they waited. Soon, Delia and a young girl appeared, laughing together like old friends. Hey, guys, said Delia. This is Sana. I think she wants to take us somewhere, or something like that. She turned to Sana. Jared, she said, pointing at her friend. Jared, repeated Sana. Lou, said Delia, this time pointing at the furry guide. Lou, Sana repeated with a grin. Hello, Sana, said Jared awkwardly. Sana blushed and hid her face. I don't think she's supposed to talk to men or boys, said Delia. They seem to have some rules about that sort of thing. Her mother gets to speak, but that's because she's special somehow. I don't know. The word means something like teacher. Oh, said Jared. Well, okay then, I guess. Are we ready to go? Sure, said Delia. Where are we going anyway? I couldn't quite understand what Sana was trying to tell me. To see the dragon, said Lou seriously. The one that lives at the heart of the volcano. Oh, said Delia, as her smile and her confidence faded. Geez, these dragons, they keep getting harder and harder to get to. Lou laughed. Not to worry. Sana knows the way. The four of them waved goodbye to the assembled tribes people and headed off into the mountain to meet the green dragon, Zelyonoff. And that's the end of installment 14. Your next dragon task is to learn to say a few words in a foreign language. Or, if that's hard for you, try to read a myth or a fairy tale from another part of the world. Thank you for listening, and I will be back later this week with installment 15. Take care. I love you.